Most esteemed colleagues, please, first of all, allow me to thank you for the opportunity and the organizers for the opportunity to speak in the premises of such outstanding institution. This year, we have joined the forum, the White Knights of Oncology.
It doesn't work.
We have joined the conference and our event, the School of Surgery, which actually was conducted in the in 2013 and 2014. And today, actually, we talk mainly about the main and result issues in the surgery for gastric cancer. I would like to say that we used to have many more questions. Now we know how to do the lymphodisection, how to reconstruct the GI tract, and nonetheless, the treatment of such severe category of patients remain to be unsatisfactory in many ways. So, I would like to also show you the journal Clinical Hospital, where we publish our most recent achievements of our events, and also we when we speak about 5-year survival rate in this category of patients, we see that the outcomes of treatment in European countries and North America do not overcome 30% of 5-year survival, whereas in Japan it reaches 60%. So most probably we have some reasons for this, and one of them is standardization of limb dissection, which is performed simultaneously almost in all settings of Japan. I would like to say that the volume of lymph dissection is very stringently regulated in the, by the preoperative staging. We can see here that clinical staging of T, N, and M stages is important to decide the to understand the volume of lymph dissection. But at the moment, the strategy of surgery in gastric cancer is also can also be envisaged by the preoperative staging. What we can propose for now in order to have correct staging, preoperative staging. First of all, this is the set of radio methods of examination on or imaging, and if endoscopy allows us to differentiate between the early cancers, and almost it is almost impossible to use without ultrasound enhancement for the deeper set malformations, then CT by the data of world statistics demonstrates wonderful, just wonderful outcomes of such imaging. CT is not that informative from the viewpoint of assessment regional recurrence or M staging, but in T category, I would like to say that the detection of T1, T3 malformations as well as metastatic distant metastasis is quite informative. So CT is quite informative here. MRI allows us to compare different modes, T-weighted and fat sat. With this great diversity of modes allows us to do deep diagnostics and also to be quite accurate in terms of T1, T3 or T4 staging. PET is highly sensitive, about 80% of sensitivity, and very high specificity. And it's a wonderful method of imaging, which is highly informative in controversial data. If we have controversial data in MSCT or MRI in terms of staging. What do we see as results of imaging? The detection rate of tumors does not overcome 15%, and predominantly these are T3 or T4 malformations. Sensitivity of MSCT doesn't overcome 57% in T4 tumors in 85% of patients. The tumor is not described in after imaging, after MRI, and staging leaves much to be desired, as well as and sonography. Here we can approximate approximately 70% of staging in terms of T and N categories. At the moment, we can say that CT and MRI potentials is somehow underused in the city at the moment, and endosonography at the moment compensates the insufficient use of other methods of imaging for preoperative staging. If we speak about the controversial issues of volume of limb dissection, then we should mention that there are two directions. One of them is stringent standardization and regulation of limb dissection volume, disregarding the individual features of patients, and the other approach is individualized or targeted approach, which envisages that there is an individualized targeted way of treatment for every patient with targeted volume of limb dissection. The next question under discussion is the reasonability of using bursectomy, splenectomy, which has been partially commented by the previous speaker, as well as the use of very more expanded D3 limb dissection. In terms of standardization or target or individualization, I would like to draw your attention to the old classification from the Japanese Oncology Society, where you can see that localization of lesion in the stomach influences the type of limb dissection, and also it regulates the volume of the lymph nodes removal in the D2 type of surgery. In fourth revision, this classification has been simplified. It has been classified as a distal resection and extirpation, stomach extirpation, but nonetheless, today we can see that our Japanese colleagues are very meticulous in terms of mapping the lymph nodes and registering these lymph happen simultaneously to the assessment of the volume of lymph nodes to be removed. So registers are utterly important, and this is one of the most important questions that we can resolve in Russia at the for now. We should be speaking not about the numbers of lymph nodes and the topography, but also about the approaches that we can use. It's very important to say that the tumor cells can occur not only inside the lymph nodes, isolated tumor cells with a diameter up to 0.0 millimeters or micrometastasis can also be present in the lymph nodes, in the fatty tissue around the lymph nodes, and the removal of the lymph node alone as enucleate without the removal of the fatty tissue around it is not a radical approach to D2 limb dissection. So in this respect, I can say that we can talk about unblock limb dissection. We cannot actually avoid embryo-oriented surgery, and bursectomy can be done, as it is shown here on this slide, by chipping the petals of the colon, or if you do D2 limb dissection without bursectomy, we open the pancreatic capsule on the upper margin, the superior margin of the pancreatic gland and of the pancreas. And at the moment, the meta-analysis of the prospective studies, which was performed by a group of Chinese authors, came to the conclusion that bursectomy does not improve the long-term outcome of relapse-free 5-year survival of patients after bursectomy. And alongside with the bursectomy alone, we have much more aggressive limb dissection afterwards, which increases the potential complications rate, like the development of pancreatic fistula or post-operative pancreatitis, as we call it in our Russian literature. And GCOGPR T1. These are patients with T1, T4 tumors, especially in the cases when the tumor invades into the mucinous, into the mucus. And most probably, we shall have other or new recommendations for prostatectomy. Peritoneal lavage, the positive tumor, the tumor cells, positive tumor cells, or presence of tumor cells in this in lavage was a counterindication to surgery. But in 2012, we received the data that even patients with a positive cytology, as a result of combined treatment, we can achieve quite good outcome in terms of 5-year relapse-free survival in of 26% for 3 years and 21% 5 years survival. This changed our attitude to this cohort or to this patients. According to the recent guidelines, which is not published in English yet, the peritoneal lavage is recommended in all clinical stages of T2 and above that. And the positive cytology is not a counterindication to radical surgeries any longer. This is an unfavorable prognostic signal or factor, which probably signals about not a reasonable surgery, aggressive surgery like resection of the pancreas and so on. And in case of high risk of relapses, such as type 3 and 4 of macroscopic stomach cancers. Of course, staging laparoscopy is quite beneficial, strategic approach for preoperative planning, and over 50% of patients as a result of preoperative chemotherapy can be shifted from cytologically positive to cytologically negative. Subsequently, further on, they can be indicated for radical gastrectomy. The question of splenectomy has already been outlined in full detail, so I'm going to just repeat that according to the recent guidelines, according to 10-01-10 study, the prophylactic or preventative splenectomy is not reasonable, and splenic sparing surgeries are much more reasonable in a particular groups of patients. In the para-aortal lymphadenectomy, the study 9501 showed that the difference in survival between the groups with a D3 limb dissection and without it are not present. If we differentiate patients according to their para-aortal lymph nodes, then somewhat better survival is marked in D3 lymph dissections and in somewhat worse in the positive status of lymph nodes. But this study 0405 at the moment demonstrates that in case of preoperative chemotherapy in patients with a detected para-aortal lymph nodes, according to the clinical studies, their survival rate, 5-year survival rate, doesn't overcome 10% in the no adjuvant treatment and D3 limb dissection following it, or paraortal D2 lymphadenectomy, we can achieve 3-year survival of 59% and 5-year survival of 51%. Thus, as of today, the preventative D3 limb dissection is not reasonable, but alongside with that, the further on development of the prognostic criteria and patient selection for such surgeries combined with the preoperative chemotherapy, I suppose, will be discussed in the contemporary guidelines and recommendations to come. And this is one of the recent Italian publications which shows that the selection by histotype allows us in certain cases to demonstrate quite efficient D3 lymphodissection in quite aggressive diffuse type of stomach cancer. And of course, we cannot forget about the interaction with the contemporary achievements of molecular genetics. For example, in case if we have an opportunity for targeted therapy, then of course such category of patients have much more optimistic forecasts. And laparoscopic gastrectomy, I suppose this is one of the most controversial aspects of oncology, and you have seen the reference to the fourth update of guidelines, which is not published in English yet. But we understand already that for early cancers, laparoscopic distal resection is becoming standard procedure. But in terms of locally disseminated cancer, locally advanced cancer, the situation which we come across most frequently, the situation is blurred and obscure. We have a number of prospective randomized studies, and we, of course, follow the Japanese and the Korean studies, which standardize patients quite stringently by the volume of limb dissection. And class one study has just been finalized, which demonstrated that laparoscopic distal resection in early cancers is not worse than open surgery. All the other studies at the moment are still at the stage of data processing, or there is continuous enrollment of patients, and only the assessment of long-term result can answer the question whether laparoscopic surgery is really applicable in the locally advanced cancers of the stomach. The problem of laparoscopic surgery are the problems of adequate lymph dissection, and many educational seminars and the schools are devoted to this. Also, it's very difficult in massive malformations to avoid the surgical principles, as we need to manipulate with the stomach, and very frequently we have to be in contact with the tumor. In laparoscopic surgery, we need to use thermal energy, ultrasound energy, quite extensively, which can also impact the oncological outcomes and surgical outcomes as well. Some increase in the pancreatic fistula sometimes is related to the unfavorable use of the thermal energy. The problem of adequate reconstruction of the total gastrectomy, this is exactly what the previous speaker talked about. Inconsistency of stenosis, again, all our colleagues register this. Such complications, they continue increasing, and of course the problem of the learning curve. These are exactly the main stumbling blocks. And the most problematic anastomosis, I'd like to say that there are two concepts, anti-peristaltic end-to-end anastomosis and isoperistaltic overlap. The last one was mentioned by the previous speaker. I suppose it's much more beneficial in terms of the minimal tension of tissue. And the same principle is used in the anastomosis selection algorithm. When, for example, there are problems with the tissue, like this stomach stump is quite small, or massive mesentery of the colon, then we can use the overlap anastomosis, the isoperistaltic type or principle. When we need a technically simpler option, then we use the functional end-to-end. The trends in the development of laparoscopic surgery and reconstructive stage is the strive to use the linear closure materials, closure techniques, and this is not a mitigating factor. And technically speaking, it allows us much easier to perform reconstructive stage of surgery. But nonetheless, this approach at the moment is the most vulnerable in laparoscopic surgery of stomach cancer. And the laparoscopic surgery has a different role from the viewpoint of contemporary concept of fast-track protocols or fast recovery protocols. At the moment, it's the most prosperous directions of surgery. This is the introduction of this multimodal system in all areas of medicine and surgery, from colorectal surgery, and at the moment, all surgeons stick to these protocols. In this complex multimodal system, the use of preoperative, intraoperative, and postoperative interdisciplinary interaction with the fast track protocol. Laparoscopy, of course, is part of these protocols because it allows us to have all the conditions for early mobilization and early recovery of patients. It's not the speed that matters, but it's the speed of much more harmonic and much more healthy recovery and a reduction of the number of post-operative complications. In conclusion, I would like to mention the main vectors of surgical methodology development in stomach cancer, basing upon the main positions of my talk. First of all, it's the balance of standardization on the individualization of treatment protocols. It should be standardized, otherwise it will be chaotic. But at the moment, many researchers are looking into stepping aside from the standards in order to feel much more optimal options for surgical problems. And despite the fact that standardization and individualization seem to be just two sides, there seems to be opposite to one another. They are two sides of one coin, I would like to say. Multimodal approaches means cooperation of all the specialists, and only such multidisciplinary approach to preoperative and postoperative planning, in fact, allows us to have good outcomes and the balance of aggressive and low invasive surgery. It should be aggressive in order to be radical in terms of limb dissection, but it should be low invasive and not traumatizing for the patient. And again, despite the fact that they can be contrary to one another, these are again two sides of one coin, and they are related to one another. And low invasive does not mean just narrow approach or narrow cut. If you open the door slightly, then unfortunately, in many cases, you can see this type of mess even through a very, very small hole in the door. So it doesn't actually, it is not important how wide you open the door, but it's the functional order inside the patient that is most important. Thank you for your attention. Thank you very much, Viktor Anatolievich. And dear colleagues, we have an opportunity for a couple of questions. Do we have questions in the room? I would like to ask from the practical healthcare, so D2, D3 on the right and on the left, what are the indications and what is the difference from the paraortal limb dissection? When I was speaking about D3 limb dissection, I meant actually D2 plus paraortal. For clinical practice, I would like to say that it's too early to recommend this technique, as it is quite complicated, sophisticated, very associated with a great deal of complications, and it can be only performed by expert centers and experienced specialists with big numbers of surgeries. I suppose that these techniques can be used only in big oncology settings with very high volume of surgeries.